This is an undated photo of Buxton resident George Neal sitting in the tailor shop he owned. And this is George Neal with his family. The black miners were paid the same wages as the white ones, and many, like the Neals, were able to afford fine clothes and, in some cases, even to buy cars. One of Aunt Catherine's earliest memories is of the difficulties of driving in Buxton.
Let me tell you something. You know, they didn't have sidewalks and paved streets, and my father had a Model A, and we got stuck in the mud. He could not get the car out of the mud. So he goes down inside of the coal mines and brings a mule out. And then the mule pulls us out of the ditch.
Oh, wow.
And then he takes the mule back, and then we go on our way.
The town's general store, frequented by both whites and blacks, has been described as one of the best of that time west of Chicago. Buxton also had YMCAs, one with an indoor swimming pool, a reading room stocked with history books, and out-of-town newspapers from as far away as New York City. In a documentary about Buxton, broadcast on Iowa Public Television some 30 years ago, the now-deceased Marjorie Brown talked about the extraordinarily good times blacks there enjoyed. Her father was a miner and then an engineer. Her mother was a choir director.
I didn't know there was any other way to live. The black people had the ball team, the black people had the band, the black people had the hotel, the black people had the YMCA. In fact, Buxton was the only place in the world that had a dual building YMCA set up, one for the adults and one for the children. And I thought that's the way everybody in the world lived. When we think of lifestyle, I can truthfully tell you, I never in my life lived in a house where there wasn't a musical instrument, where there were not newspapers, where there were not books. I never ate at a bare table because they hadn't polished tables, hadn't come in style, so it was tablecloths. I never lived in a house that was uncarpeted. That was our lifestyle, and I wasn't alone. All of the youngsters that I played with, we all lived the same way.
But the good times in Buxton were drawing to a close by the mid-1920s. The coal deposits had been used up, and the town's miners had to move to other communities to find work. Without mining, there was no reason for the town to exist. It rapidly shut down and, as you've seen, all but disappeared. Once they moved, Buxton's black residents were confronted with a harsh new reality, which was really the way of the world at that time. Lower paying, often menial jobs, and racial slights they had never known growing up in Buxton. Marjorie Brown's family moved to Cedar Rapids. She quickly learned that all the talents she had acquired in Buxton were not appreciated, even a little there.
It was a brand new world. It was a brand new thing for me. I had to unlearn so much and then learn again. I had to unlearn that Marjorie was an important part of a community and learn again that she was second, third, fourth, or unknown.
David Gradwall was among those who conducted the interviews for the Iowa State University study.
When they moved to the larger communities, particularly the African Americans, they did not have the same opportunities. There were people who had high school and college education and had been working in sorts of positions in Buxton that couldn't get those jobs. I think there were, like teachers who became house cleaners when they moved into these other areas. We were just having a conversation at a Buxton Club meeting, and a gentleman that I was talking to said, in Buxton, we had our own lawyers, we had our own doctors and dentists and school teachers, and then we moved to Des Moines and stepped back 100 years. And that really stuck with me.
After Buxton's decline, Sarge moved his family to another mining town, Bucknell. Then, a few years later, to Des Moines. Only then, as a teenager, did Catherine discover what was so commonplace at that time, segregation.
There was not one white family on that whole street. Mm. Now that's when I first became aware there was a difference.
So you learned that from your neighbors and your new friends?
And the kids at school. They called you black and everything else sometimes they could call you. I think that's the first fight I had was someone had done something to Geraldine, your grandmother.
Yes.
And of course I had to jump in because she was my youngest sister.
Both Catherine and her kid sister, Geraldine, went on to graduate from college and have successful careers as teachers. And both insist neither race nor racism has defined their lives. Still, 70, even 80 years later, Catherine distinctly remembers a number of racist incidents once she left Buxton and moved to Des Moines. One occurred during high school.
There was a white girl that lost her purse. She couldn't find her purse. I was the only black student in that class. And guess what? She told the counselor, I used to remember her name, that I had taken her purse. In fact, she found it later. But do you think she came and said, I'm sorry? Nothing at all.
She says another incident occurred years later.
When I worked at the YWCA in Des Moines, Cat's Drugstore was segregated. You remember that, do you?
Mm-hmm.
The railroad station was segregated. Then they bought in a little store that sold orange juice and sandwiches. So I was going to lunch and I said, I think I'll try this plate. I went in there and ordered me orange juice and a sandwich. She gave me my orange juice in a paper container and I was only black in there and all the whites had a glass. So I says to her, why did you give me this drink in the paper? She said, because that is what we do. We don't serve black folks with a glass. I said, thank you, gave it back to her and walked out.
20 or 30 years later, Catherine's nephew and Jason's dad, Jerry Madison, grew up in Des Moines feeling demeaned. He was angered by what he considered the derogatory portrayal of blacks, including the song, Old Black Joe.
Old Black Joe.
He's still bitter about having to sit in the balcony to see a movie at the Paramount Theater in Des Moines, about not being served at Katz's, just like his Aunt Catherine, and as an adult, about facing hostility from white homeowners when he performed his duties as a city housing inspector.
And I used to go to them places and they didn't expect a black person to come to their house. And so when I went there, you know, what are you here for? I said, what do you mean? They didn't like me to tell them what to do about their property.
Throughout the reporting of this story, we were struck by how similar the language Jason, his great aunt, and his dad all used to describe a sense of being judged unfavorably by whites. Though the three of them are separated by age and circumstance, each describe moments when they say they were made to feel like outsiders, like the other. The 95-year-old recalls her early school days in Des Moines.
You felt bad because you didn't know what you had done to make them angry with you when you hadn't done anything.
Her nephew, Jerry, puts it this way.
You know, you always put out there like you're doing something wrong or something, you know, or if I'm not qualified or something. You know, and what do you have to be, you have to really experience it. And I just can't just sit here and talk about this.
Even his son, Jason, who was still only 26 years old, describes his own pain feelings.
I don't want to say you can't relate to other people outside of your own race, but it becomes kind of a struggle, you know, at times, and because you know that you're different. I can't really speak on other individuals. I can only speak about, you know, about myself and just kind of growing up, you know, you always thought there's always like a double standard, you would say. Like, you always had to prove yourself over and over and over. And it wears on you.
All of these complicated feelings about race that endure today makes what happened in Buxton that much more remarkable. To this day, no one quite knows why Buxton developed the way it did. Was it because the coal mine operators, the Buxton family, were spatially enlightened? Did it have anything to do with the concept of welfare capitalism that emerged during that era? Or something else altogether? Even those who have studied this almost unparalleled story of prosperity and harmony admit to being uncertain.
I think we really know a good bit about Buxton, but there are many things we don't know. And one of the great unknowns to me is, did John Buxton or Ben Buxton really envision something of an African-American utopia? Did they really see this as a place where racial harmony would exist, for families would be treated equally? When the men went into the mines, they would receive equal pay for equal work. We don't know that.
Whatever it was, Jason Madison and others now believe that what happened in Buxton needs to be taught in Iowa schools and nationally, that the story not be lost, that history be preserved.
Well, I think it's extremely important for young people and even old people to know where they fit into history. What is their place? We're not just little isolated specks floating out. And I guess that's what I find exciting. If that could exist at that time in Iowa, then why can't it exist all over the United States today?
If these tales weren't told and these stories from previous generations weren't told, we wouldn't have any idea about it. I mean, it's something that wasn't taught in the schools that much. This is definitely something that is unique to Iowa and definitely needs to be shared.
To find out more about Buxton, go to the Iowa Public Television website, iptv.org. I'm Simon Estes. Thank you for joining us. Funding for Searching for Buxton has been provided by William Penn University and Musco Lighting, who are proud to support the telling of this Iowa story.